Welcome to Space News from the Electric Universe, brought to you by the Thunderbolts Project at thunderbolts.info.
The fundamental difference between the Electric Universe and standard cosmology can probably be summarized as follows. The Electric Universe is a connected universe, where nothing is born or exists in isolation. Filamentary networks of electric currents pervade space, producing the magnetic fields that are now detected at virtually all scales throughout the universe. Yet even as the existence of electric currents in space has slowly entered the astronomical literature, astronomers still view gravity as the predominant force in the cosmos. Today, Bishop Nicholas Sykes discusses the Electric Universe foundations for a new understanding of many phenomena in nature, including our own sun.
David Talbot points out that the ancients spoke of the thunderbolt ruling the universe. When we transpose their conceptual language into our own, the ancients seem to have got it right. Electric universe theorists maintain that it is the transportation of electrical energy that the plasma facilitates that makes the stars shine, including our sun, and produces all the electromagnetic radiation found in nature. The solar wind, so-called, the galactic currents, and the intergalactic electric circuits all play their part in maintaining the existence of the universe and in maintaining human existence. These electrical power systems form connected parts of the great plasma engine that rules and empowers our universe. The above statements are in conflict with most of today's accepted astronomy and cosmology theories, which operate on the premise that electric fields, currents, and plasma discharges are not important mechanisms in space. Until recently, only gravitational fields were asserted to be important. But more recently, the importance of magnetic fields has also been admitted. Even so, such a premise is becoming increasingly difficult to maintain with any honesty, on two accounts. One, that it is generally known that magnetic fields of all sorts are caused by electric currents. And two, that in the era of the space age, it becomes increasingly difficult to avoid the natural conclusion of many observations clearly showing the universe to be highly electrical in nature. Furthermore, since we observe in everyday life that electrical forces are vastly stronger than gravitational forces, how long can it be maintained in all seriousness that for driving the universe, the vastly stronger force is to be ignored, while the much weaker gravitational force is to be asserted? Electric universe theory does not postulate where, when, or how such a vast electrical power transportation might have come into being. EU theory is concerned very much with producing tangible evidence that the things about which it speaks are indeed true and verifiable. Dr. Donald Scott, for instance, produces convincing calculations showing that the collection of electrons from the space around the sun can be enough to produce the sun's output of radiation, given the observed features such as the electrical potentials and the temperatures of the various spheres, photosphere, chromosphere, corona, and heliosphere, by which the sun is characterized. In the EU model of the sun's photosphere acts as an anode and will continue to do so for as long as it maintains a sufficiently positive potential difference to the plasma of the heliosphere from which it collects negative electrons and to which it discharges positive ions. The magnetic field-aligned currents called Birkeland currents that sustain this positive potential are generated by the great plasma engine of the universe. The sun is empowered from outside itself, as are the stars in general. And as Dr. Scott points out, there is no telling when or for how long the sun or any other particular star will be sustained. There is considerable evidence coming to light about the variability of star sustenance and output. But thankfully, there appears to be a verifiable mechanism that greatly stabilizes our sun's light output in spite of its varying electrical environment. The plasma state is characterized by matter in subatomic form, be this form positive ions or electrons or both. The particle inhabitants of the plasma state exist therefore in a state of lower organization than their counterparts in the three other states. The higher organization makes for greater stability, but the electrical nature of the energy transfers across lengths of plasma, as in fluorescent lights, or expanses of plasma, as in space, requires a medium of charged but movable particles. It was demonstrated to me and many others as school children that 1. Plasma through which a low current density passes operates in dark current mode. You cannot see any glow, but radio waves can be radiated. 2. When the current density is increased, a point is reached at which the potential difference up to this point increasing between the electrodes connecting to the plasma suddenly drops, and the plasma starts to glow. An example of this is the fluorescent lamp, which needs some sort of starter to get it going. This mode is called the normal glow mode. There is a third mode of plasma operation called the arc mode, which cannot be demonstrated with the same sort of equipment, which would be destroyed if the current density were increased further. Nevertheless, it may be demonstrated by generating an electrical spark between two metal spheres or by the electric welding arc. Again, it has long been known to be necessary to begin the spark with a relatively high voltage difference, which drops when the discharge begins to operate. In these cases, the air between the electrodes, even at atmospheric pressure, breaks down to become a conductive plasma. A useful primer on these discharge characteristics by D.E. Scott is published on the internet. Armed by the familiar knowledge of these three modes in which plasma operates electrically, it is possible to make much better sense not only of our own sun, but of an abundance of cosmological observations, including those customarily accounted for by the much-touted magnetic reconnection. Stephen Smith relates, for instance, that astronomers using the Wide Field Infrared Survey Explorer, WISE, are reported to have located a star, Zeta Ophiuchi, whose, and I quote, powerful winds push gas and dust out of its way and into what is called a bow shock. It is conventionally assumed that the star's velocity compresses gas and dust in front of it as it flies through space because its so-termed stellar wind shoves gas and dust out of the way. The so-termed bow shock is said to heat up the interstellar medium, ISM, until it glows in the infrared frequencies that WISE can see. However, Smith points out that instead of treating the interstellar medium like an inert medium, the electric universe model sees it as an electrically charged material that is affected by the plasma sheaths around stars. Stellar plasma and the interstellar medium are different plasmas, so they develop Langmuir plasma sheaths or double layers between them. While the photospheres of stars are where galactic electric anode discharges are focused, double boundary layers form the corresponding virtual cathodes, and in the case of our sun, this is the heliospheric boundary.
For continuous updates on space news from the Electric Universe, stay tuned to thunderbolts.info.